This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Ernest Bracebridge School Days by William H. G. Kingston. Chapter 1: The School, the Master, and His Boys. It was a half holiday. One of our fellows, who had lately taken his degree and passed as senior wrangler, had asked it for us. He had just come down for a few hours to see the doctor and the old place. How we cheered him! How proudly the doctor looked at him! What a great man we thought him! He was a great man, for he had won a great victory, not only over his fellow men, not only over his books, by compelling them to give up the knowledge they contained, but over his love of pleasure, over a tendency to indolence, over his temper and passions, and now Henry Martin was able to commence the earnest struggle of life with the consciousness which of itself gives strength, that he had obtained the most important of all victories, that over self. There he stood, surrounded by some of the bigger boys who had been at school with him, a pleasant smile on his countenance as he looked about him on the old familiar scenes. Then he shook hands with the fellows standing near him, and we all cheered again louder than ever. He thanked us, and said that he hoped he should often meet many of us in the world, and that he should always look back with pleasure to the days he had spent in that place. At last he once more waved his hand, and went back into the house. The instant dinner was over, out we all rushed into the playground. Those were happy times when, directly after it, we could stand on our heads, play high cock olorum, or hang by our heels from the crossbars of our gymnastic poles without the slightest inconvenience. Our school was a good one. I ought to speak well of it. I have, indeed, a very small opinion of a boy who does not think highly and speak highly of his own school, and feel thoroughly identified with it, provided it is a good one. Our school, at all events, was first-rate, and so was our master. We were proud of him, and believed firmly that there were very few men in England, or in the world for that matter, who were equal to him. He won the affections of all of us, and as it seemed, with wonderful ease. How he did it, we did not trouble ourselves to consider. I have since, however, often thought over the subject, and have had no difficulty in guessing the cause of his influence. He was a ripe scholar, and thoroughly understood what he professed to teach. Then he was always just, and although he was strict, and could be very severe on occasions, he was one of the kindest-hearted men I ever met. We all thought so, and boys are not bad judges of their elders. He was a tall, fine man, with a florid complexion. His eyes were large and clear, and full of intelligence and expression. And then his voice, how rich and mellow it sounded when he exerted it. His smile, too, was particularly pleasing, and old as he was, at least as we thought him, he entered heartily into many of our games and amusements, and it was a fine thing to see him stand up with a bat in his hand and send the ball flying over the hedge into the other field. He had been a great cricketer at college, and had generally been one of the 11 when any university match was played, so we heard, and that made him encourage all sorts of sports and pastimes. He pulled a capital oar, and we heard that he had been very great at football, though he had long since given up playing. Indeed, I doubt if there was any game which he had not played well, and could not still play better than most people, had he chosen. Such was Dr. Carr, the doctor as we called him, of Grafton Hall. Grafton Hall was a fine old place, situated on a healthy spot, and surrounded by good-sized grounds. Indeed, no place could be more admirably fitted for a first-rate gentleman's school. The house was a large Elizabethan building, with a number of good-sized airy rooms and passages and staircases. The hall served, for what it was originally intended, as a dining hall. The doctor had built a wing, in which was situated our schoolroom, and a lofty, well-ventilated room it was. We had several lecture rooms besides, and then the large old courtyard served as a capital playground in wet weather, as well as a racket court, And in one corner of it we had our gymnasium, which was one of the many capital things belonging to the school. A fine wide glade in the park, which had been thoroughly drained, served us as a magnificent cricket ground, and there was, not far from it, a good-sized pond through which ran a stream of clear water, where we bathed in the summer. It was kept clean and free from weeds, and even in the deepest parts we could, on a sunny day, see the bright pebbles shining at the bottom. I need not now give a further description of the dear old place. We were, most of us, as fond of it as if it had been our father's property. I do not mean to say that it was a perfect paradise. I do not fancy such a place exists in the world, and if it did, I must own that schoolboys are not, as a rule, much like angels. Still, the doctor did his best to make it a happy place, and an abode fit for boys of refined minds and gentlemanly habits and ideas. It was generally our own faults if anything went wrong. When a new boy arrived, the doctor took him into the schoolroom and lecture rooms and dining hall, and through the sleeping rooms and playground and gardens, indeed all round the place. "Now, my lad," he used to say, "you will remark that everything is well arranged and clean and neat. I trust to your honor to refrain from injuring anything in any way, and to do your best to keep the place in the good order in which you see it." On no occasion had he ever to speak again on the subject, for we all took a pride in the handsome, gentlemanly appearance of the house and grounds, and effectually prevented any mischievously inclined boy from injuring them. All the other arrangements of the establishment were equally good with those I have described. The doctor's wife was a first-rate person, so kind and gentle and considerate. We were all very fond of her, and so we were of the good matron, Mrs. Smith, who kept all the people under her in such excellent order. The ushers, too, were all very good in their way, for the doctor seldom made a mistake in selecting them. They were good scholars and gentlemen, and generally entered with zest into most of our sports and games. But it is time that I should return to that memorable half-holiday. The doctor had not long before erected a gymnasium, which was at this time all the rage among us. We never grew tired of practicing on it. The moment we came out of the dining hall, the greater number of us assembled round it. Some swarmed up the poles, others the ropes which hung from the bars above, several performed various exercises on the parallel bars, while four seized the ropes which hung from a long perpendicular pole, and were soon seen with giant strides rotating round it, till they scarcely touched the ground with their feet. Numbers were likewise hanging on to the horizontal bar, sitting on it, swinging by it, circling it, kicking it, hanging to it by the legs or the feet, performing, indeed, more movements than I can well describe. There were also several wooden horses, or rather logs of wood on legs, on which the boys were mounting and dismounting, vaulting on to them, leaping along them or over them, kneeling on them, jumping off them, and indeed going through a variety of movements which might give them confidence on horseback. Several swings were in full action. Very few boys were sitting on them. Most of them were standing upright. Some were holding on with two hands, others only with one. Some standing on one foot and holding on by one rope, others leaning with perfect composure against one rope, but all were moving rapidly in one way or another. Indeed, the effect to a person unaccustomed to the scene must have been very curious. One of the most active fellows we had at that time was Richard Blackhall. He was not quite the cock of the school, though, for his size, he was very strong, but at all gymnastic feats he beat nearly everybody. His chief rival was Miles Lemon, who could perform most of the exercises he could, and did some of them better. Lemon was not so strong as Blackhall, but he had a more correct eye and a calmer temper, both very important qualifications, especially in most athletic exercises. He was, in consequence, a better cricketer and a still better fencer. Even at the broadsword exercise, Although at first it might appear that Blackhall was far superior to Miles, the latter had more than once given proof that it was hard work for anyone to gain a victory over him. Blackhall's great fault was a strong inclination to bully. He was a tyrant and utterly indifferent to the feelings of others. If he wanted a thing done, he did not consider what trouble and annoyance it might give others, but confiding in his strength, he made all the smaller boys do what he wanted. If they refused, he thrashed them till they promised to obey him. He was a great talker, and a never-ceasing boaster of what he had done, and of what he could do and would do. As he certainly could do many of the things he talked about, it was believed that he could do everything. Some believed in him, but others did not. Such a person was, however, sure to have a number of followers and ardent admirers, who quoted him on all occasions, stuck by him through thick or thin, right or wrong, and looked upon him as one of the finest fellows in existence. Among the most constant of his followers was Robert Dawson, Bobby Dawson he was always called. He was not a badly inclined little fellow, but he had no confidence in himself, and consequently wanted to lean on somebody else. Unfortunately, he chose Blackhall as his supporter. Among the smaller boys, who aspired to be considered something above the common, was Tommy Bolden. He was a determined, independent little fellow. He was very active, and could perform more feats of activity than any other boy of his size. He was a fair cricketer, and was sometimes chosen by some of the bigger fellows to play in their matches. This made Tommy rather cocky at times, but he was a good-natured chap, and managed to live on good terms with everybody. Tommy, like Blackhall, was rather apt to boast of what he had done, or he purposed doing, but in one respect he was different. He never exaggerated in his descriptions of his past exploits, and seldom failed to perform whatever he undertook to do. The boys I have described were among the many who were exercising away with all their might and main on the gymnastic poles. Blackhall was going up a ladder, hand over hand, without using his feet, while Lemon was swarming up a pole. When they reached the top, giddy as was the height, they crossed each other and descended, one by the pole and the other by the rope, head foremost. Then, without stopping, each climbed on some horizontal bars. Lemon first hung by his hands to the bar he had seized, and then he drew himself up until his chest touched the bar. Then, lowering himself, he passed one of his feet through his hands and hitched his knee over the bar. Then he swung backwards and came up sitting on the bar with one leg. It was easy enough to draw the other leg after him. Throwing himself off, he caught the bar again by his hands and curled his body over it. "That's all very fine," exclaimed Blackhall, who had been sitting on a bar observing him. "But, old fellow, can you do this?" Blackhall, as he spoke, threw himself off the bar, grasping it with both hands. Then he passed the left knee through the right arm, so as to let the knee rest in the elbow. Then he passed the right knee over the instep of the left foot, and letting go his left hand, he grasped his right foot with it. Thus he hung, suspended by his right hand, and coiled up like a ball. After hanging thus for a couple of minutes, he caught the bar by his other hand, and uncoiling himself, brought his feet between his arms, and allowed them to drop till they nearly touched the ground. Then he turned back the same way. Once more lifting himself up, he threw his legs over the bar, and dropping straight down, hung by his bent knees with his head towards the ground. A little fellow passing at the moment he called him, and lifted him off the ground, a feat which called forth the loud applause of all his admirers. This excited him to further efforts, and he was induced to continue still longer, when he found that Lemon did not seem inclined to vie with him. While the exercises I have described were going forward, the doctor made his appearance at the door of the yard, accompanied by a boy who looked curiously round at what was taking place. After waiting a minute or so, the doctor led him on through the grounds. "I wonder who that chap is," observed Tommy Bolden. "He looks a regular built sawney." Oh, don't you know? He's the new fellow, answered Bobby Dawson. I heard something about him from Sandon, who lives in the same county, 10 or 12 miles from his father's house. The families visit, that is to say, the elders go and stay at each other's houses, but Sandon has never met this fellow himself, so he could only tell me what he had heard. One thing he knows for certain, that he has never been at school before, so he must be a regular muff, don't you see? His father is a sort of philosopher, brings up his children unlike anybody else, makes them learn all about insects and flowers and birds and beasts and astronomy, and teaches them to do all sorts of things besides, but nothing that is of any use in the world that I know of. Now I'll wager young Hopeful has never played football or cricket in his life, and couldn't if he was to try. Those sort of fellows, in my opinion, are only fit to keep tame rabbits and silkworms. Master Bobby did not exactly define to what sort of character he alluded, and it is possible he might have been mistaken as to his opinion of the new boy. Well, I agree with you, observed Tommy Bolden, drawing himself up to his full height of 3 feet 7 inches and looking very consequential. I hate those homebred missy, milk and water chaps. It is a pity they should ever come to school at all. They are more fit to be turned into nursery maids, and to look after their little brothers and sisters. This sally of wit drew forth a shout of laughter from Bobby Dawson, who forthwith settled in his mind that he would precious soon take the shine out of the new boy. But I say, what is the fellow's name? Asked Tommy. Oh, didn't I tell you? Answered Bobby. It's Bracebridge, his Christian name is. Let me see, I heard it. I know it's one of your fancy romantic mama's pet boy names, just what young ladies put in little children's storybooks. Oh, I have it now, Ernest Bracebridge. I don't see that that is so very much out of the way either, observed Bolden. I've known 2 or 3 Ernests who were not bad sorts of fellows. There was Ernest Hyde, who was a capital cricketer, and Ernest Eastgate, who was one of the best runners I ever met. Still, from what you tell me, I fully expect that this Ernest Bracebridge will turn out no great shakes. While the lads were speaking, the subject of their remarks returned to the playground. An unprejudiced person would certainly not have designated him as a muff. He was an active, well-built boy of between 12 and 13 years old. He had light brown hair, curling slightly, with a fair complexion and a good color. His mouth showed a good deal of firmness, and he had clear, honest eyes with no little amount of humor in them. He was dressed in a dark blue jacket, white trousers, and a cloth cap. Dawson and Bolden eyed him narrowly. What they thought of him, after a nearer scrutiny, they did not say. He stood at a little distance from the gymnasium, watching with very evident interest the exercises of the boys. He had, it seemed, when he first came in with the doctor, been attracted with what he had seen, and had come back again as soon as he was at liberty. He drew nearer and nearer as he gained more and more confidence, till he got close up to where Dawson and Bolden were swinging lazily on some crossbars. Blackhall was at that moment playing off some of his most difficult feats, such as I have already described. I say, young fellow, can you do anything like that? Said Tommy, addressing Ernest and pointing at Blackhall. Dawson here swears there isn't another fellow in England who can come up to him. I beg your pardon, did you speak to me? Asked Ernest, looking at Tommy as if he considered the question had not been put in the most civil way. Yes, of course, young one, I did. There's no one behind you, is there? Answered Tommy. What's more, too, I expect an answer. Perhaps I might, with a little practice, answered the new boy carelessly. I'm rather fond of athletic exercises. I'll be content to see you get up that pole, young un, observed Tommy, putting his tongue in his cheek. Take care you don't burn your fingers as you come down. I'll try, if I may, replied the new boy quietly. He advanced towards the pole, but another boy got hold of it, rather a bungler he seemed. So Ernest left him to puff and blow by himself in his vain efforts at getting up, and went on to one of the swinging ropes. He seized it well above his head, and pressing his knees and feet against it, steadily drew himself up, to the surprise of Bolden and Dawson, and several other lookers-on till he reached the lofty crossbar. Was he coming down again? No. He sprang up and ran along the beam with fearless steps till he came to the part into which the top of the pole was fixed. Most of the boys thought that he would come down by the ladder, but stooping down, he swung himself onto the pole and slid down headfirst to the ground. There he stood, looking as cool and unconcerned as if he had not moved from the spot. The feat he had performed, though not difficult, was one which neither Dawson nor Bolden had yet attempted. It raised him wonderfully, in the opinion of those young gentlemen. "Very well, young one," exclaimed Tommy in a patronizing tone. "I did not think you'd have done it half as well. However, I suppose it's the trick you have practiced. You couldn't do now what that big fellow there, Blackhall, is about." "Oh, yes," said Ernest quietly. "I can kick the bar, or swing on it, or circle it, or do the grasshopper, or hang by my legs, or make a true lover's knot, or pass through my arms, or hang by my feet. You fancy that I am boasting, but the fact is this, my father won't let us do anything imperfectly. If we do it at all, he says, we must do it well." "Oh, I dare say that's all right, young one," observed Tommy, turning away with Dawson. "I see how it is. He has been coached well up in gymnastics, but when he comes to play cricket or football, it will be a very different affair. A fellow may learn one thing or so at home very well, but he soon breaks down when he comes to practice work." A few only of the boys had remarked Ernest's performances. Most of them were too much engaged in their own exercises to think of him. He felt rather solitary when left to himself, and wished that Dawson and Bolden would have stopped to talk to him, not that he particularly admired their manners. He was well prepared, however, to meet all sorts of characters. School and its inner life had been described to him by his father with faithful accuracy. Although at the time few, if any, private schools were to be found superior to Grafton Hall, Ernest did not expect to find it as happy a place as his own home, much less a paradise. A number of little boys were playing a game of ring-taw in a corner of the yard. Ernest walked up to them. No one took any notice of him, but went on with their game. "Knuckle down," was the cry. A sturdy little fellow, with a well-bronzed hand, was peppering away, knocking marble after marble out of the ring with his taw, and bid fair to win all that remained. Ernest had long ago given up marbles himself, but he did not pretend to forget how to play with them. He thought that if he offered to join them, it might serve as an introduction. "If you will let me, I shall like to play with you," he said quietly, catching the eye of the sturdy player. "With all my heart," was the answer. "Thank you. But I must buy a taw and some marbles," said Ernest. "I did not think of bringing any." "Oh, I will lend you some," answered the boy. "Here, this taw is a prime one. It will win you half the marbles in the ring if you play well." Ernest thanked his new friend, and took the taw and a dozen marbles with a smile. He was amused at finding himself about to play marbles with some boys, most of whom were so much younger than himself. His new friend had cleared the ring, and a fresh game was about to begin. He put down 8 of his marbles, and as there were several players, a large number were collected. The first player had shot out 4 or 5 marbles. When his taw remaining in the ring, he had to put them all back and go out. Ernest was kneeling down to take his turn, when Blackhall, tired of his gymnastic exercises, came sauntering by. "What are you about there, you fellows?" "I'll join you," he exclaimed. "How many down?" 8. "Oh, very well." Without more ado, he was stooping down to shooting from the offing, when Ernest observed that he had taken his turn. "Who are you, I should like to know, you little upstart?" cried Blackhall, eyeing the newcomer with great disdain. "Get out of my way, or I will kick you over." "Indeed I shall not," exclaimed Ernest, who had never been spoken to in that style before, but whose whole spirit rose instantly in rebellion against anything like tyranny or injustice. Without speaking further, he stooped down and shot his taw with considerable effect along the edges of the ring of marbles. It knocked out several and stopped a little way outside. "Didn't you hear me?" exclaimed Blackhall furiously. "Get out of my way, I say." Ernest did not move, but took his taw and again fired, with the same effect as before. Blackhall's fury was now at its highest pitch. He rushed at Ernest, and lifting him with his foot sent him spinning along the ground. Ernest was not hurt, so he got up and said, "I wonder you can treat a stranger so. However, the time will come when you will not dare to do it." "Shame, shame!" shouted several of the little fellows, snatching up their marbles and running away, for they were accustomed to be treated in that way by Blackhall. Ernest was left with his first acquaintance standing by his side, while the bully walked on, observing, "Very well, you'll catch it another time, let me promise you." "That's right," exclaimed Ernest's companion. "I'm glad you treated him so. It's the only way. If I was bigger, I would, but he thrashes me so unmercifully, whenever I stick up against him, that I've got rather sick of opposing him." "Help me," said Ernest, "and we'll see what can be done." The other boy put out his hand, and pressing that of the newcomer, said, "I will." The compact was then and there sealed, not to be broken, and the boys felt that they understood each other. "What is your name?" said Ernest. "It is curious that I should not know it, and yet I feel as if I was a friend of yours." "My name is John Butter," answered the boy. "I have heard yours. You are to be in our room, for the matron told me a new boy was coming today, though I little thought what sort of a fellow he was to be. But come along, I'll show you round the bounds. We may not go outside for the next 3 weeks, for some of the big fellows got into a row, and we have been kept in ever since." So Johnny Butter, as he was called, ran on. He let Ernest into the politics of the school, and gave him a great deal of valuable information. Ernest listened attentively, and asked several questions on important points, all of which Butter answered in a satisfactory way. "This is a very jolly place altogether, you see," he remarked. "What is wrong is generally owing to our own faults, or rather to that of the big fellows. For instance, the doctor knows nothing of the bullying which goes forward. If he knew what sort of a fellow Blackhall is, he would very soon send him to the right about, I suspect. We might tell of him, of course, but that would never do, so he goes on and gets worse and worse. The only way is to set up against him, as you did today. If everybody did that, we should soon put him down." Ernest was very much interested in all he saw. Notwithstanding the example he had just had, he thought that it might be a very good sort of place. Butter introduced him to several boys, who, he said, were very nice fellows, so that before many hours had passed, Ernest found himself with a considerable number of acquaintances, and even Dawson and Bolden condescended to speak rationally to him. A number of boys having collected, a game of prisoners' base was proposed. Ernest did not know the rules of the game, but he quickly learnt them, and soon got as much excited as anyone. His new friend John Butter was captain on one side, while Tommy Bolden was leader of the opposite party. Each chose 10 followers. A hedge formed their base, 2 plots being marked out close to it, one of which was occupied by each party. 2 circles were formed about 100 yards off for prisons. "Chevy, Chevy, Chevy," shouted Butter, rushing out. Bolden gave chase after him. They were looked upon as cocks of their set, and the chase was exciting. Bolden was very nearly catching Butter when Ernest darted out to his rescue. "Now, Tommy, you must put your best leg foremost or you will be caught to a certainty." What twisting and turning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.